Good morning, everybody. This is Battle Cat. I'm sitting here watching my TV. I'm watching these little black ghetto bastards tearing up stores, tearing up their neighborhood, all in the name of what? Police brutality? All in the name of who? Freddie Gray? Give me a break.
Ago in Ferguson and Baltimore, now drawing praise from President Obama. Praise the president thanking the leaders of the Black Lives Matter movement, thanking them for their efforts.
We've also got some young people here who are making history as we speak, led many of the protests that took place there and shined a light on the injustice that was happening. People like Jared Kesson, who's done some outstanding work mobilizing in Baltimore around these issues.
Leaders from that movement were honored guests at the White House in honor of Black History Month.
Ladies and gentlemen, it's 1776 worldwide.
So, is there an epidemic of racial violence loose in America today? There is. According to the National Crime Victimization Survey, in 2010, 62,593 blacks were the victims of white violence. During that same year, 320,082 whites were the victims of black violence. That's five times as many violent attacks, but that number is misleading, since the black and white populations are not the same size. When 38 million black Americans commit five times as many violent crimes on 197 million whites as they receive, what you discover is that black perpetrators violently assault white victims 25 times more frequently. And when it comes to a specific kind of violent crime, aggravated assault, the number of black on white crimes is 200 times higher than white on black crimes. Oh, there's an epidemic of racial violence in America. Reporter and author Colin Flaherty has taken a cold, clear-eyed view of the statistics that don't make the news because they're suppressed by the news. He reports, for example, again in 2010, the National Crime Victimization Survey reported approximately 13,000 black-on-white rapes and 39,000 black-on-white robberies, both violent crimes. The statistics show that the number of white-on-black rapes and violent robberies were so small that they had to be rounded to the nearest whole number, and that whole number was zero. Now, of course, critics will say that I'm using these statistics to justify the murder of Michael Brown, but I said at the beginning, if Michael Brown was shot in cold blood, then the police officer needs to pay the price for that murder. This has nothing to do with Michael Brown. This has everything to do with the narrative that the president, the attorney general, and all of these race hustlers are trying to create using Michael Brown. Because there is, in fact, a racial war of violence and hatred in America, open racism is simply not tolerated in white America today, but black racism is the toxic glue that holds the progressive coalition together. Tolerance of, in fact, as we see from the events in Ferguson, open encouragement of black rage at a narrative that not only does not exist, but reverses the daily outrages that do exist, is what defines modern progressivism. It's the politics of envy, anger, entitlement, lawlessness, violence, and bald-faced lies. And of all of the promises broken by this man, surely none is more heartbreaking than the one promise that got him elected in the first place, the promise of a post-racial future. He and his progressive cohorts can never surrender the weapon that's gotten them everything, not the least of which is personal political power and trillions of dollars of redistributed wealth. And this latest outrage in Ferguson is yet another example, as if another was needed, among the economic wreckage, creeping totalitarianism, and foreign policy disasters, that he and his leftist cohorts would rather rule over ruins than disappear into the dustbin of history of a healthy and racially healed nation.
And even though we have a president like this now, we're more racially divided than we've ever been. Under the first black president that mostly white people voted for, we're more divided than we ever. Rob Emanuel said, they never let any good crisis go to waste. You know what I mean? I know a lot of black men that look like me dead, and they've been killed by other men that look like me. My brother, best friends. You know what I mean? So that, you know, there's real issues that we're going to. And I don't like the fact that the Democratic plantation always tries to play off of the real pain and suffering that we have in the black community. Yeah, so black people need to wake up. And under Hillary, basically, we've been divided racially, and I think now it's time to divide us under the gender-wise. Now it's to divide us against man versus woman, straight versus homosexual.
I reject both the liberal view, which holds that black failure is largely or mainly due to discrimination, and I reject the view that it's genetic. So I focus on cultural differences. And I point out, for example, that in virtually every measure of academic achievement or economic performance, we find not just whites, but immigrants, Cubans, West Indians, Koreans, leapfrogging ahead of American blacks and claiming the fruits of the American dream.
So me as an African American, I have a 2,000 times more likelihood to be shot and killed by another black man leaving this event than I do by a white person, a police officer, a neo-Nazi.
So you don't think that's
2,000 times more percent. I mean, we're killing us as African Americans, we're killing each other. That's what the real fucking problem is.
Yo, this is a reverse mirror. She supposed to be talking.
I'm being honest with you. That's what the problem is.
That's
what the problem is. This is me and my brother right here. We gotta stand together, man. Oh, but listen. I'm being honest. If Obama would have stood up and said, look, we're killing each other, we've got a problem within the African American community, he would have been phenomenal. But he's gonna make it white people right, and
of course you walked away.
Nothing there, you left, man.
Yeah, the word,
man. I'm just being honest.
You're a young motherfucker, man.
You recently find identity politics.
I'm just being honest. I just had to say that, man. I'm being honest. I'm just completely honest. I'm 2,000 times more likely to be shot and killed by another black man leaving this event today, tonight, than I am any other race, color, creed, or police officer. That's where the fucking pain comes, man. That's sad. I can't hang out in black neighborhoods. I can't do that because it's a risk for me. It's a risk. It's sad. There's a problem within the African American community and it needs to be addressed. Obama didn't address it because he wanted the black vote, and Al Sharpton didn't address it because he's making millions of dollars off of victimizing African Americans. Trust me. I know how that is.
Among the differences between the two eras, that is to say, the time you grew up in Harlem and the 60s, was that the intelligentsia, both black and white, became more prone in the later period to make excuses for moral squalor and barbaric behavior. Your words here. Mm-hmm. After such notions permeated the society, barbaric behavior and moral squalor became accepted norms within some segments. Close quote. So you are not merely making the argument, I'm asking, that the liberal view that what was in their minds dictated the behavior of African Americans, that you're not merely making the view that liberals were mistaken, you're making the view you're making the argument that they were culpable.
Yes. And as I point out in a few places in the book, you can go to England and see the very same pattern emerging, including this pattern where kids in school who are trying to do well get beaten up by other kids. What's the same in both places is that the intellectuals have told them that the world is unjust, that other people are keeping them down, that the fact that they don't have what other people have is somebody else's fault. And if you buy that vision, then of course there's no reason for you to do well in school. And you resent those who do well because they've bought into the enemy's way of thinking.
I'm not understanding how you can commit violent crimes against other blacks, but your blackness won't come into question. You may be admonished for black-on-black crimes, but you won't be seen as less black. You can gun down another black person while calling them the N-word and still be considered authentically black. You can sell another black woman for prostitution, and your blackness will be celebrated, player. You can sell another black person drugs for them to ruin their lives. I mean, these are the actions of true sellouts, but their blackness doesn't come into question. But if you simply disagree with a Democrat who's black, in this case, Obama, you hate your own people. Or if you're not black, you hate blacks.
You know anything about the Constitution?
I said you're a house nigga. I didn't call you a nigga.
Oh, okay. That's a big difference.
Right.
Oh, gentleman, Uncle Tom.
Yeah.
And so, what should I be? Like you?
You don't
like you?
Know me. You don't know me.
That's
you
don't right. Know and don't want to know you.
You know
but
know
I know your type.
What's my type, then?
Uneducated, underinformed, and misinformed.
I'm uneducated.
Right.
Are you sure about that?
Yeah.
You sure about that?
Yeah, but what you say, by what you say to me, yes.
Oh, what you saying, you sound very uneducated and very stupid.
No, I don't.
Yes, you do.
No,
you
I don't.
You sound very stupid.
Man. Okay.
So right, you tell plus, we have reasons.
Oh, is that right?
He just made a threat.
Yeah, I know.
Hey, film that, please.
I know.
Say it again. Hey, say
so
that
you're going to kill me?
No, not me.
Then what'd you come over here for?
No, he pointed a gun at us just now and he pulled the trigger.
Fuck you. I can do what I want.
Do it.
Yeah, fuck y'all.
I know. He was. You should put the finger. You can put the finger.
Well, let's talk.
All y'all get hit by.
Why are you voting for Hillary?
I ain't voting for Hillary. Fuck that bitch, too.
Then what's your point?
What are you standing for?
Fuck all y'all.
Fuck all y'all. Okay, there's a
great solution. That's it?
That's the best you can
that's
do.
It.
Well, it might be better for us to vote for Hillary. That may,
yeah,
you're
yeah,
actually
that's
helping
good,
us.
Yeah.
Thank
you're
you very much. Help. Thank you very much.
Yeah.
You go right ahead. You keep that up.
You are the master. You're the most obvious and laughable fucking stereotype possible, imaginable. It's almost unreal.
There are a lot of people in the black community who actually think the way that I do. But it's very risky to actually say it, because then you'll be called a name, you'll be scorned, and that is what the established Progressive Party wants. They don't want anybody to speak out against this, and they want to demonize anybody who does so, because they want to maintain their power. And I think a lot of people are starting to wake up. I'm not sure they're going to be able to maintain this grasp over the black community going into the future. I'm certainly hoping that's the case.
You say that black people are being shot every single day is a lie. You know, I think 965 black people died last year, and of that, I think 40% of them were white, and the other 30% were Latinos, and then others, what have you. So black people, I think as a percentage, it was like 17%, and they're 13% of the population, which means on average, I mean, when you actually scale it down, they're pretty much represented fairly. And by the way, there's only 1 million police officers in America. 1 million police officers that are policing 320, 340 million Americans, right? So when 900 of the people die, justly or unjustly, you're not even talking about 0.1%. That is like a 99% satisfaction rate, and when it comes down to policing.
So there's no discrimination in the United States.
I didn't say that. Of course there's discrimination. There's discrimination. Are you married? I mean, when you pick your husband, you're going to discriminate against a lot of men. I mean, there's discrimination of all sorts. I'm not saying that there's no discrimination. I'm not saying that there's no racism. But I don't think that the police officers are systematically racist. And I don't think it's a problem, to be honest with you, in America.
So you said there is racism and discrimination. What would Donald Trump do about it?
I don't think Donald Trump can really do anything about discrimination or racism, because it's a single thing, right? So I mean, if I wanted to be outwardly racist to somebody because I woke up on the wrong side of the bed, how is Donald Trump going to stop me? Is he going to put in a law that's going to throw me in prison? Well, then there's going to be a lot of free speech violations and what have you. Donald Trump, no president can stop somebody from being racist. It's your own thoughts. That's called thought policing, and I don't think that we don't want that in America. Got it?
Yeah. It didn't fit with the agenda, but it was good.
make sure you post that online.
I done told the truth and they mad now. They mad. So, but one thing I want to know is, why you mad? Okay? So, I heard that I was getting kicked out the black community, and I had to think for a minute. So I'm thinking like, well, what is the disadvantages of getting kicked out the black community? I'll wait. What's the disadvantage? Because I'm trying to figure out what the benefit was. But I know damn well half the black community I was in owed me some money. So I ain't leaving till I get my money back. You can believe that. And then, some other comments I seen. So, they're calling me whitewashed. Uncle Tom, Uncle Rukus. But all I know is, I do got an Uncle Tom, and he's a motherfucking millionaire. And I'm still trying to figure out, what does whitewash mean? I wait.
Token, bootlicker, Uncle Tom, Sambo Tom, coconut as in brown on the outside, white on the inside, Oreo, same concept, the Antichrist.
Man, you got
because they've got to malign somebody like me. I am a bigger threat to their whole ideology than almost anybody else. A black guy who does not believe that he's a victim, a black guy who believes in hard work and personal responsibility, a black guy who doesn't believe in handouts, a black guy who doesn't believe in the welfare state, a black guy who doesn't believe in affirmative action. I am the antithesis of everything they stand for. And therefore, I can't just be dealt with facts and rebutted with facts. I've got to be maligned. I've got to be cast away. I've got to be treated as if I'm Darth Vader. That's what the left does.
So in a way, that is actually showing
racism. It's racist. Of course it is.
That's
bigotry.
Right, because
I don't have the same right to have an opinion as somebody else. I've never heard Rush Limbaugh be called anti-white because he criticizes Hillary and the left.
Listen, look, you see this young man right here? This young man has a bright future, and I love that. I love the fact that this young man has a bright future. So how am I a white supremacist?
A token little person, right?
I've never even met this man before.
Token little person. That's how they think of it, folks.
So unbelievably, this is racism. This is racism.
She calls me white supremacist. I have a young black man next to me. I say, hey, look, this guy's awesome. He's a friend of mine. I love him. And she's like, oh, you're little token person. How rude, how racist. And she says it right to his face.
And
that's how they think that they literally think they're beyond reproach.
He literally goes from having this bright smile on his face to the saddest looking expression on his face, and it's heartbreaking.
Yeah,
it really
exactly.
Is.
You can see when I reach out and I grab him, his face lights up. He's like, yes, I'm part of something. I'm part of building a future. And then this witch, look at his face. Look at how happy he is. He's like, yeah. And then this witch insults him.
He's a sellout. He's an Uncle Tom. He doesn't understand our pain. He's just trying to get attention. He doesn't realize how we've been victimized. You say what?
It's sad, Neil, because it's the mindset. Don't be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. So if you have a finite mind, if you have a degenerated mind, of course you're going to type that, because you can't understand where I'm coming from. In God is newness. In God there's redemption. You understand? I'm not a man that's going to go to the past. You said I'm dragging you down. Is Al Sharpton lifting you up? Come on now, okay? This is not rocket science. You cannot go any lower than where you already are. Okay, God wants to take us higher as a nation. You understand? I'm not gonna hate my brother because you tell me to. And then I'm in church on Sunday telling God how much I love him. You are false and a hypocrite. Take a seat. Because even the Bible tells you, how can you say you love God when you hate your brethren? So I'm not about racism. I'm not about dividing. I'm not about foolishness. This is about advocating the word of God. This is about exegeting the text of what it says and living by it.
But you know,
you
every
understand?
Time all white people are racist, all men are misogynistic, all cisgender people are transphobic.
All white people are racist. So I put this up because I really want any white person in the room to know up front that this is what we're dealing with, that it's not going to be this coddling of white tears and what that looks like. We're not going to discuss, oh, maybe some of us have worked it out. No, you're always going to be racist, actually. So even when you're on your path to trying to figure out how to be a better human being, because I believe that white people are born into not being human, like that actually instead of people of color and black folks being dehumanized, that actually everyone is dehumanized off rip within white supremacy, that y'all are born into a life to not be human, and that's what y'all are taught to do, to be demons. So in this particular way, white people are all racist. So I just want y'all to know that up front.
Everybody.
I want today, I want tomorrow, I want to wear them like braids in my hair, and I don't want to share them.
Here's the thing. Some people might watch this video and think that I'm speaking out against black people. Actually, that's not true, and it couldn't be more the opposite. What I'm doing here is speaking up for black people, for the millions of us who do not think like this, who are not this ignorant, who are not this petulant, and who would never list something so low-aiming as the list that this girl presented to the community. It is incumbent upon each and every one of us black people, who are aiming for education and advancement in society by not dwelling on the past, but looking towards our futures, to stand up and to say that this is absolutely and utterly reprehensible. Reprehensible not just because of its fantastical elements, but because it truly paints a grotesque picture of the African-American community. It paints us like hobos and beggars who cannot accomplish anything on our own without sticking our hands out. It is an absolute shame that a woman like this is given a platform to speak, period.
How, you have to ask yourself eventually, what are these people defending? You know, what are they trying to, like, what are they trying to get across? What's their fucking message? Because if your message is, you know, treat black people the way anyone else should be treated, you know, treat black people with respect and dignity, treat black people like humans, you know, like actually rational, insane, intelligent human beings who are worthy of respect. If that's your message, but you go and act like this, the message is fucking lost. There's no point in you saying shit like that. If you really want people to stop, you know, like denying black people loans because they're automatically presumed to be irresponsible, if you want people to stop following you around when you go into high-end, you know, shopping districts or, you know, department stores, if you want to be treated with respect, you have to display respectable behavior. That's the one thing that I never see from Black Lives Matter. They never take responsibility. They never invoke the importance of personal responsibility. They're always just asking some sort of external entity to help them out. They're always asking for handouts from corporate America. They're always asking for universities to give them special, you know, quotas or, you know, affirmative action to help them get in to get higher education. They're always asking government, you know, to change their laws or change their practices, you know, to help black communities. They're always asking for some sort of, you know, institutional policy to be enacted. They never just say, hey, maybe I, as an individual, should take the power upon myself to try and change my community. Maybe I should change my actions first. And if I change my actions, maybe that'll influence someone else to change their actions. And if they change their actions, maybe some other people, 10 other people will change their actions. Then 100 more, then 1,000 more, then 100,000 more, then 1,000,000 more. And over time, maybe there won't be anything to point to when people claim that there's so much crime in the black community. Maybe there won't be anything to point to when people claim there's so much sexual promiscuity and familial irresponsibility. Maybe, just maybe, if you exemplify the traits that you, the characteristics that you want people to display to you, to treat you as, to respect, civility, you know, intellectual, you know, honesty, compassion, you know, just being a good fucking person, you know, if you want them to treat you like any respectable human being, maybe you want to act like it first and not like this stupid ass bitch. Yes, I'm talking to you if you're watching this. Yo, dumbass. People like this, not acting like this all the fucking time.
What he should be doing is blaming his black brethren, who is a criminal, and that
or if not blaming, at least recognizing that that is the source of the problem. Look, immigrant groups have always said, for example, Italian communities living in New York would always be exceptionally angry if the grandson Vito was caught stealing or was caught involved in some crime, because they would say, look, you are giving the Italian community a bad name. In other words, you are making us all look like we are part of the mafia or part of organized crime, and we will be especially severe on you. There is absolutely no such accountability, at least on no systematic level, in the black community. That the reason that the cab driver is acting this way is because the Sentencing Commission, a liberal advocacy group, recently released a study. 1 in 3 African Americans in the United States is on any given day in prison, on parole, or on probation. These are staggeringly high crime rates. And the point is, by changing those patterns of behavior, we make racial discrimination less likely. I argue that that's the best anti-racism now.
I'm sitting here watching these little black bastards in these fancy suits. They get on CNN talking about, well, the youth, what they doing is based on a larger problem. Larger problem, my ass. I'll tell you what the problem is. The problem is the people who raising them. The people who raising them are not putting a foot so far up their ass that they wouldn't even know what looting is. A lot of these little black bastards, little ghetto bastards, they're being raised by ghetto parents or ghetto uncles and aunts. I'll tell you what the problem is. The problem right now, I'm not talking about Jim Crow time. I'm talking about right now. The problem right now as black people, they are seriously misinformed. They are seriously confused. They're letting their sons, especially their sons, they're protecting their sons while their sons go out and commit crimes and their sons got a place to lay their goddamn heads. Our neighborhoods are dumps. You know why it's dumps? Because little black bastards, they in there, they involved in gang activity, they involved in selling drugs, they involved in robberies, robbing people of their phones, just doing all kind of shit. And then they got a place to go and run home to. Cause auntie or mommy or grandma gonna protect they ass. And I tell you what, even the families that protect they ass, they need to be dealt with too. Because these people, they so busy wanting to protect their family members and don't give a fuck about the neighborhoods that are suffering at the hands of their piece of shit family members. This something has got to change. Black people, real black people, need to wake up. They need to wake up, they need to come together and go against these little black horde pieces of shit. These little niggas, I can't fucking stand them. I can't stand them. I don't even, you know, you can take this video and make it go viral. You can call me a Uncle Ruckus. You can call me a black person hater. I don't care what you call me. But the facts is the facts. What's going on now is not white people's fault. It's not white people's problem. It's a black problem. And it's one that needs to be fixed. And needs to be dealt with today. Battlecat.
What's happening? Like I said, it's responsibility. Parents out there, take responsibility for your kids. I'm not going to advocate Al Sharpton shouldn't and make this a race issue because you have irresponsible, disobedient, hell-bent kids. Okay, take responsibility for your kids. It starts at home. Okay, if you're not raising your children at home and you expect the streets to, don't get upset when they put them in their place. That goes for every race. If you want to categorize it, that goes for every race. If you're out there cutting up, acting wild and foul, these police officers that shoot up every single day are not here to babysit your rebellious children. They're not. So don't get upset when they have to take action, whatever means necessary, because you have a rebellious child. Okay? I'm not going to protest in front of a police department about Black Lives Matter when your son has a rap sheet like a 5-year-old's Christmas list. I'm not doing it. And these activists shouldn't either. It starts with you as a parent, as a father, as a mother. Take responsibility for your children's behavior. It ain't even about race. Raise that bar. Raise your agenda of what you want. It is time for you to change it because we're going into a whole nother year, 2015. God is not bringing this foolishness of what's in store for humanity. He said in Isaiah 43:19, check it. Behold, I do a new thing. Shall you not know it? I'll make a path in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. God is doing a new thing. We're going forward, not backwards. And I want people to know that from worldwide, all over the globe, because this foolishness has to stop.
Furthermore, if you really believe that there's institutional racism, if you really believe that everyone at the 1% is racist, and the government's racist, you know, the corporations are racist, everyone's, you know, has some sort of inherent, you know, prejudice against black people and minorities, and they're just looking and actively pursuing the opportunity to keep them down, to keep them out. If that is true, if that was true, why the fuck are you constantly asking these type of institutions to help you out? If the whole world is racist, if all of hierarchical America is racist, why the fuck would you ask them to help you out? Why the fuck are you asking the government to help you? Why the fuck are you asking corporations to help you? Why the fuck are you asking universities to help you? Why aren't you taking responsibility on your goddamn self to do some shit about your own life? Why the fuck does someone else have to help you out of a rut? Why does somebody else... Oh my god, I don't think you guys really understand how fucking pissed I am at this. And it's not really something that's new. This is something that I believe I've held for a long ass time. And I'm just tired of it. As the title says, I'm sick of you niggas. I am sick and tired of the irresponsibility, the lack of accountability, the victim status, the victimhood, the fact that everything's always, it's always someone else's fault. No, if you act like this, shit is your fault. If you fail in life, if you can't really achieve anything because you act like this, because you threaten people, because you are always fighting with each other, because you're always killing each other, if that's why the incarceration rates are so high, if that's why, you know, people, if that's why black people can't achieve in life, it's your fucking fault. It's your fault, nigga. Do better. Do better. Do better, man.
Let's be blunt. What about the murders in our own communities that we don't want to take responsibility to? What about them? We have raised Michael Brown up when Michael Brown's been being killed in our community every single day. From Los Angeles, Flint, Michigan, New York, Boston, Atlanta, St. Louis, all over the globe. Why is only Michael Brown the only black that's being recognized and glorified when we kill blacks on a daily? How come we can't protest to that? That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm moving on. You want to stand in front of a police department and want to put pine salt, spick and span on everything around them, but you're still living in filth. You're still living in chaos. You're still living in corruption. You're still living in foolishness that you don't want to change, but you want them on their P's and Q's. Enough. Sit down. Sit down, Al Sharpton, Jesse Jackson, or any other activist that want to push this racism going in this country, because this foolishness and responsibility needs to be brought to the forefront, plain and simple. All we know how to do is blame the police and white folks for our actions. I'm sick of it.
When is this gonna stop? When? We have toiled this mountain long enough. Understand there are bad cops out there, yes, but whatever they pulled you over for, if you didn't do nothing, what's the problem? Humble yourself. Swallow your arrogance. Let's change it, black people. How are our children supposed to grow up when we out here acting a stone fool? How? It's been over 50 years since we sang that song, We Shall Overcome. When are we gonna overcome? You activists out there, you civil rights leaders, all of a sudden, Black Panthers, NAACP come out the woodworks. They just came out of nowhere. We don't want justice. We want justice. When there was 60 plus shootings in Chicago a few weeks back, where were you? Nowhere to be found. A few weeks later, it was 47 drive-bys in one weekend. Where were you? Nowhere to be found. When Lil Ray Ray killed Lil Lucas, where were you? Nowhere to be found. Okay, when the little girl was shot when she was riding her tricycle in the front yard and stray bullets hit her, where were you? Nowhere to be found. Police beat up on a black man. Oh, no. Slavery still exists. Slavery still exists. Oh, shut up. Because I want to debunk that myth as far as being young and black and mistreated. I'm young, black, I drive a brand new BMW and live in the valley. How many encounters have I had with the police? Many. How many times has it got out of control? None. 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 Because I had many encounters with the police and I became good friends with them. Tell me how come I could live that life and you can't. Tell me. It's time for us to change as black people. And I'm not talking about that Obama change because we still waiting for that change. It's time for us to change. Stop burning down your communities and where you live because you mad at the police. Clean up your own neighborhoods and then they'll clean up theirs. Starts with you first. Let's get it together. Let's get it together because this is embarrassing. The whole country is watching us acting stupid. My kid looking at TV like, well, what's going on over there? What in the world? It's embarrassing as black people. Round and round in circles ain't working anymore. God bless you all. Keep moving forward as a nation, as a people.
This movement is about black people finally waking up and realizing that for 50 years,
when we have voted for the same party, and what is there to show for it? Poverty, fatherlessness in our societies, crime, mass black incarceration. And if you keep going down the line, it's just truly incredible. The victim mentality that tries to chain black people back to their past and tells them that you cannot be a part of the American dream because of the color of your skin, which is a lie. And that's what the Democrat Party has done to black people. It has stifled the progress of the black community.
Well, black folks can't think for themselves, and we gotta help them, and because they always getting the short end of the stick. As long as it fits that narrative, they will endorse it, they will feel it. Even if it means feeling racism, they will endorse, finance, and give a platform to these fools. You black folk can't, y'all just can't do it. The world's out to get y'all. So I gotta help y'all and try to, man, nah, shut up.
And everyone out there, the best thing you need to do, get rid of your TV. Get rid of it.